Joe, do you have a mic? It's really hard for us to hear.
You know, I don't, but I can try to yell.
Thank you.
I do it at home, I can do it at school.
Sorry about that.
Yeah, no, I apologize. And I also apologize for being in the small room tonight. We have play practice in the NPR, which is wired for audio as well, so I apologize for that. But it's good to see everybody here. There are no blue slips for item 3A, so let's move to item 4A. And we do have a number of requests to speak for item 4A.
Hey, hello, how are you?
We have a stool for you if you want to see that.
All right, thank you.
Excellent.
I feel lovely one.
Okay,
I'm
going to bring this here at 7:04. Okay, so the way we typically do this at our meetings is once the first person speaks, we'll not be accepting any more blue slips. So we'll call people in order, and I just want to count the number of folks we have.
So if anybody else wants to speak, you need to get your sheet in right away.
If you want to speak, you have to get your sheet in before the first person speaks.
And they're about to start. If you want to, if anybody wants to speak.
All right, so we have 19 speakers. Would anyone else like to speak? Okay, great. We'll go with 2 minutes for each speaker, right? I'll call them in order. And if I massacre your name, I apologize. I'm from Boston. Don't hold it against me. We'll move to item 4A, post-tenure facilities agreement with the Los Altos School District. We'll take comments first. We will not respond. Then we'll discuss amongst ourselves and take a vote. Okay? So the first blue slip we have is Kate Hillier. Kate Hillier stepped out. Margaret Pettit, it looks like. Fantastic.
Why don't we? Sit.
The smaller one. Why don't you stand over here, address the board.
There we go.
Then the air conditioning will be behind you.
I know, then I'll have that. Yeah.
Great. If you wouldn't mind, fall speakers, please address the board.
Yes.
Fantastic. I'm not going to bother calling people 2 and 3 in advance. It's a small room, but I will call as we speak. Please.
So I'm Margaret Pettit. I'm a parent of a Gardner Bullis student, third grader, and so he would be one of the first children that would be at a new location for Egan if it actually went according to plan. But I would encourage to hold off on voting or approving this plan at this time, just because for one, being at Gardner Bullis, I realize this is how this all started in the first place, was the closing of that neighborhood school, which, given my location, I would not be happy and would be fighting tooth and nail against that as well, against the closing of Gardner Bullis, the native state in that first place. I just think it'll be another mistake to close then our middle school that would be for Gardner Bullis. And I know it's moving, but in our view, it's a closing of what is Egan and moving it to a whole, I mean, it becomes a new school at that new location, even though it's a middle school. That's the feeling, the sense. And I would also just please ask you to postpone, like, to get more community input, because at this time I feel, I've talked with parents at softball games, so there's time to really come to a good consensus. And I think if it's just pushed through at this point, it's gonna really create more division in our community that I know that's not your goal, that's not the LASD board's goal. I know a peaceful solution and a solution needs to be resolved with permanent facilities for you and a good solution for LASD students, neighborhood schools right now. So please, that's just my request, is to push it off, because I do think in the long run, if this is pushed through at this point, it's going to cause more division in our community overall. Thanks.
Thank you.
Hi, so my name is Pepe, and I'm an LASD mom. My older daughter is going to be the first class to be impacted by this proposed agreement. I'm also urging you to delay signing this long-term agreement. When I got engaged in this back in November with your Prop 39 request, I co-wrote that op-ed with Courtney Corrigan. So I want to say I both oppose this agreement and stand behind everything I wrote with Courtney. In short, I am not here advocating for one solution or another. I also believe that if we sign this agreement, we're not doing the two things I had asked for in the op-ed, which is, one, the community must agree on fundamental principles from which we work backwards to have a fair deal, and two, we have to look at all the sacred cows. that we believe are untouchable and ask, are they truly untouchable? What are some creative solutions? I don't think we've exhausted all the creative solutions. I think the community, as well as myself, we were expecting a collaborative outcome based on looking at shared fundamental principles and evaluating the options together. I think with the confidential negotiations and the process, we just haven't been able to do that. You know, at the end of the day, the community is not behind this deal, and we don't see it as a deal that shows equal benefit and equal burden. I think people in this community are ready to compromise and do what's best for the common good, but we do not believe this deal is the common good. And we need more time to discuss and to evaluate and to look at what's been discussed by the board. And for us, I think many people are ready to make that compromise with the right process. If we move forward with this deal without this conversation, I think there will be permanent acrimony in this community, and that's not what we want, right? And that is not what I want. I am very, very vocal. However, I still stand behind everything I wrote in the original op-ed, which is for both sides to compromise and come to a conclusion that is good for everybody overall. So I really urge you guys to do the right thing, and thank you for everything you guys have done. I'm sure it has been a long, long process. Thank you.
Amber Donald.
Hello. My name is Amber McDonald. I'm a first-time parent of a kindergartner, and in fact, our family would be in the district until the year 2031. It's a really long time to think about going on. First of all, I wanted to thank the BCS board and the LSAD board for all the tireless work that I know you have spent on this subject. With that being said, we're back at the same point that we were almost 6 months ago when the community garnered almost 5,000 signatures against this particular solution. When our family decided to move here to Los Altos, it was because it reminded me of a small town that I grew up in the Midwest. In the busy heart of Silicon Valley, it was like this hidden little gem, a place where you could walk. School, a place where you could get your kids safely to school. That was the whole point of why we moved here, and specifically to this area. We purchased and built our forever home with the intent of being here for the foreseeable future, and we had no idea. When I say no idea, no idea that strife existed between the two schools. In fact, one of our closest neighbors became best friends with, and quickly, BCS parents, kids are best friends. Like, it seemed as though they were happily friends, they shared and played together. But it felt like it was the boards of both schools and the parents who felt like there was no other options than the current one from years of legalities and constant struggles. During the past few weeks, as I've become very ingrained in this, I have stood on the belief that in life you always have to put yourself in another person's shoes. And although there may be some beliefs about what the charter may or may not do, I do believe that as parents and school boards, we have a responsibility to be role models to our kids, to depict how a community can come together for a bigger purpose. To do this, I have and am asking each board to give both schools' communities time to really confront what each side can give or take, time to evaluate and thoroughly stand behind a new proposal that will benefit both BCS and LASD in the long term. Because the reality is, if either of us fail, we all fail our kids. In the meantime, while garnering support for a new agreement, one in which BCS continues and resides in both Block and Egan with equitable sharing and other expansions to take place for me.
Excuse me. Let's go back to King Hillier now here.
Yes, I just texted her to come back.
Okay. All right. Steph Kinesan?
Steph
Kinesan?
Yes.
Stephanie.
I'm a little bit surprised. I know you have your own way of working, but I was really hoping of actually getting input from you all on our questions that we have. I'm a parent of a true public neighborhood school, and when I say true, it is a neighborhood school, public, that cares about the community at large, not just their school. And the perception that has been put out there about this deal has been really not in a very favorable view of Bullis charter, I will say this. I don't think when we moved here 11 years ago, it was a very small thing. I don't think it's about a choice of schools that we don't want in the communities. There's a lot of private schools, there's a lot of, you know, many different schools. I think a choice of schools is wonderful. But when you look at who we're dealing with, which is really primarily the board, I don't think it's the parents and the people that want the choice of schools in the community, which we way the board is being viewed right now, that's what I was hoping to be addressed actually by you, is what your community spirit of the greater community has been, which we're not seeing at all. And we're not seeing it because we see, when we think of who we're dealing with and what we hear out there, when we go to our board meeting that is very open and that really listens to its constituents and sees what we have to say, you seem to be shut off. You don't want to hear it, you even pointed that out. I don't know if there's another meeting where you actually give such feedback, but it's not perceived as very community spirit and collaborative. When you do demands that have a lot of, you know, taking away a school and you don't even care what happens to the kids that are at Eagan in November, that seems, again, not very in the community spirit and of a district that actually supports you and the school. I would think that you would want to work with a school. Was that 2 minutes? My husband is next and he's not here. Can I take his minutes? Are you that flexible of a board? Okay, then I'll come back and turn into him.
Kate, are you back?
Yeah.
Sorry, Autumn, let's...
Yep, no worries.
Okay, fantastic.
Okay, my husband came to the last meeting, and when he and I both first heard this deal, we've been involved, I think, for probably 12 to 18 months paying attention to what's going on, so we are kind of steeped in the history. And my approach was, it was a bad deal, but if that was the deal that people were going to do, then we should try and make it a better deal. I went to a lot of the school district meetings, and the community is just not buying that. I really had a very strong message that the community is not giving the board, certainly of the Los Altos School District, a mandate to vote for that deal. I think we're fully aware that Bullis, that this board considers the tent sites a waste of resources, but the reality is that our community won't support closure of another school, and there is a North Belmina population that needs to be served properly and maybe in the long term. This places all of us, the whole community, in a bind, and we need a path to a solution. We are all neighbours, we are all part of this community, and I believe that we need to properly work together with proper community engagement, not just 12 people or 5 people or a small group of people on each board. And I think that the school district and the Bullis board owe it to the community to delay this deal, to put it off and enter into an interim solution for 2 years, while the community properly engages and we have a path to finding a solution. And I'm in true engagement, where certainly the perception from the Los Altos School District side is that Bullis is prepared to have confidential mediation and sit behind closed doors and say what it really wants, but it's not prepared to come out and engage in the difficult forum where, you know, there are some hard questions to be asked and answered. In the end, the current site solution, the Eagan moves, may be the best worst. I don't know, but I think that the community needs to answer that. I don't think that the boards should be answering that. And I think both sides owe it to the community to vote no and put in place an interim solution.
Autumn Nguyen, did I get that right?
Close enough.
Close enough.
My name is Autumn Nguyen. I have 2 children at Gardner Bullis, and we have many, many friends at BCS. In fact, we tried out BCS ourselves for a week and got a very warm welcome from the parent community here. That was really lovely. I want my friends at Bullis Charter School to have nicer facilities, your families deserve that, and I think the community at large wants that, but not at the cost of our neighborhood schools. I want you to imagine, just for a minute, that we love our schools as much as we love BCS. Don't force Eagan to close. Here's an example of how this affects me personally. If Eagan moves, it will no longer be a neighborhood school. As a single parent, I was looking forward to having our oldest bike to Eagan when the time comes. If this agreement passes, it won't be safe to bike anymore. I can't ask a 6th or 7th grader to cross El Camino, it wouldn't be safe. So then I'll have 2 drop-offs, one at Gardner Bullis and one north of El Camino at the same time. You can't do it as a single parent. Thanks for your time, and I hope you can delay this decision long enough to give the community a chance to weigh in and help you find some creative options.
Allison,
you're
good.
Hi, my name is Allison Biggs. I have 2 boys at Santa Rita, 1st and 3rd grade. We live just down the block. I can see Eagan out my front door. come by here all the time. We love your kindergarten playground, actually. We're always here playing. It's very nice. And I just came tonight to listen. As was said, I just sort of feel like I don't know what goes on at BCS. I don't know what you guys are thinking, how you feel about this plan. Really much of anything. It feels like there's a black hole of information. So I was hoping to just be able to hear a little more about how you feel and what you're thinking. And then just to make sure, I want to know more about what your parents think. I mean, I've been going to all the LASD meetings, and it's all LASD parents, and we have a lot to say. But I haven't heard from a single BCS parent about this, and I'm just hoping you really engage them in this process, and that maybe there could even be a way that we could have a forum together and actually discuss this like grown-ups. Because sometimes I feel like we're actually not quite doing that, and I'd like to see that happen. Taking a whole 2 minutes, sorry.
Maybe someone else can
use it. Hi, so my kids are older. I have three. One is going to junior year at high school. My middle daughter is going to start her freshman year at high school, and my youngest will start seventh grade. My ex-husband lives literally right next door at San Diego, so I'm very excited to walk. And the kids stay with me. I actually live over there in the village apartments in Long And having been here now in the district for many years, and this is my oldest for a while, my biggest concern is really the divisiveness, the outcry that we're hearing from our community. Certainly, similar to what Allison said, I don't really necessarily know what the BCS community was, although I have very good friends whose children go there. But from LASD, there's been a significant outcry. One of the things that I was very grateful for to enter into our current 5-year agreement, which is about to close, was that I felt that it was significant outcry from both communities that really led the two boards to come together and try to find a board solution. Now, 5 years, as it turns out, was not enough time to really come up with something permanent. And in seeing the reactions, I feel that we are about to enter yet another incredibly acrimonious phase that nobody would want. My impression is that there's quite a bit of fear behind, A, what will happen if we sign the agreement. There is just as much fear behind what will happen if we do not stay. And to me, in either of those scenarios, the fear and acrimony behind it doesn't seem like either scenario is a good choice. So again, I would ask for more time, certainly to collect more input from your own community as well, and not to revisit things of years past. I will make a final note that on a personal level, I think a tent site over there, where I live, is much needed. I've watched the Mountain View things that have been happening. I follow the Federated Realty purchase. I know the housing that's been put in. I think that 10 sites will be included. I also feel that Bullis, after all these years, deserves their own site as well. So I try to bring a balanced perspective on how people do this.
All the people standing, I do apologize that there's a small room tonight. Normally, we've been in the NPR for four states, so thank
Yeah,
we read announced that once people started talking, we jumped ahead and then we said they were interested to announce that. So you can certainly feel free to email us when any of or happy to have terms for us on email. I guess Sam Hart?
Well, nice to be here. I did exactly that. I sent an email to all of you who remember that because I knew and know who you are and you know who I am. So I'm an old timer. I've been here for a long time. Kids are grown. They went to all the schools. So I'm a proponent of our greater community. I'm going to be very brief. Same thing. I hope you will not approve this particular agreement. Number two, I hope that you will, however you can do it, open your board to the community by election, by appointment, but get the community involved in your board. And three, be open to all the options. There are so many of them that some have to be. Thank you.
Please go across. Can we raise this fine? Herb Marshall, it looks like.
So I'm Herb Marshall. I have two kids in Santa Rita and one more coming. I voted for Measure N because I believe if we could find a campus for BCS, we could end the litigation and start building bridges. But this new campus would not be as expensive as an existing neighborhood school. spend the year to discuss what fairness and true compromise on both sides look like. This community is engaged and motivated. We can work to find a common solution and move forward. But if you move forward with this deal, you become further encamped in the trenches of this war. This deal will only further divide our community. I'm a member of the Los Angeles Rotary Club, and we have a yardstick we use called the four-way test, which it's a nonpartisan, non-secretary ethical guidelines for Rotarians to use. It's, is it the truth? Is it fair to all that's concerned? Does it build goodwill and friendships? Is it beneficial for all concerned? We need to strive for a solution that meets these core values. This one fails miserably. Please take a leadership position and show BCS is truly a good neighbor and has both BCS and the community's interests in mind. Please get back to me.
Ted Crean.
Yeah.
Sweet. How do you pronounce your
surname, sir? Ted.
Your surname?
Sweet.
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 Thank you. Sorry about that.
Yep. Hi, my name is Ted. Egan parent. So we just moved here recently, 2 years ago. New from the community. Then started learning this type of words recently. I'm just starting learning the history, but look at the talk to the other parents. I feel that it's really rash decisions. It doesn't help any side. So it's going to be hurt both sides and the community. So here's my analogy. So because if you look at the deals, like you want to make the deals, I believe everyone here want to help the children, right? These deals will remove the options for people and impose hypothetical caps for you guys and kill the other good school for the other side. So it's a loss situations. So I believe all the people here is more creative and heard a lot of good suggestions. So I wish you guys to think about it, postpone the solutions, to spend more time to think, come up with better ones, and get really the community involved as everyone said.
Hi, my name is Jack, parent of five. We have three at Santa Rita and this little one who will be in the district for a while. We've been in the neighborhood since 2014, and one of the things that has been the most amazing thing about the community is, you know, Santa Rita's had a tradition of having block parties started by parents. And those block parties bring families together in the neighborhood, although started by Santa Rita parents, you know, other, there are BCS families who come join. And it's truly a unique experience. Like families, friends, I've met many parents that I otherwise probably wouldn't have met as easily. But that's just an example of what happens when you have a community school and having a neighborhood school. And I think it's really, really, truly special. And I think that's one of those things where we want to do what we can to preserve what makes Los Altos attractive and unique. But beyond that, I think one of my biggest concerns is just looking at all the parents who've been coming to LASD meetings, the parents who've shown up today, there's a genuine desire to figure out how we as a community can come together to solve this problem. And I certainly understand that you know, all of you have been working on this for a very long time. It's very challenging. But if this deal goes through, I think that many parents don't feel they have the transparency, myself included, on all the different options, and that this is truly the best decision. And it will result, and it has already started to result in divides. There's tension between the families and the communities. It's not healthy. It won't get better. I think I personally would love to understand better what, you know, the BCS board's goals are, to understand how do we jointly come to a great solution. But I can't say that I understand that. My wife asked me to speak today, and I was like, well, I actually would love to know what the goal, what the board is looking for, but I don't think the community understands that, and I think some people have echoed that. As part of the outpouring of interest, I think there's gonna be a lot more engagement moving forward. And so I'm optimistic that, you know, that if we don't push this bill through, we will get more better collaboration than we've been able to in the past.
Carol Cooper,
thank you, Joe, and thank you too. I'm Carol Kuiper, and I have lived in this community since 1973. And so I'm here primarily as somebody who cares deeply about community and all the children in the community, including BCS and including Los Altos School District. And in terms of this rancorous history, there's blame enough to go around. We had a tone-deaf school board this issue started. We had angry parents who felt betrayed and used their wealth, their power, their skills to bend the law to their wishes. We had a county board of education whose hubris thought it knew better than locally elected school board members. So the community, that's all of us, have suffered because of the past, in my view. And so BCS, I believe, holds the key to resolving what should be a very unified community, because I don't see anything different about the families who go to BCS and the families who go to LASD in terms of expectation for academic excellence. Los Altos Elementary District is one of the finest public school districts in the entire nation. And I don't see anything different in the education that you're offering. And so, as a public charter school, your first charge is to public education. That means all the children and free public education, because taxpayers' dollars, mine, support you, and you are answerable to the taxpayer, not just to a particular group of children, and to all the children. So, because I pay taxes for public education because of the foundation of this democracy. And you have a responsibility to this democracy. If you want, and here's my radical proposal.
Carol, thank you.
Come
Carol,
back
thank
to
you very
LASD.
Much for
your timing is very arbitrary.
Carol, I appreciate your comments. Thank you very much.
Okay,
thank
so my
much.
Radical proposal, come back to Los Altos School District and
Carol,
make the
Carol,
public schools
Carol, Carol,
offer the education
you
want
you
for your
yeah.
children.
You've got 2 minutes. Thank
you
very much.
Well, you could have given people free. It's the only item. It's the only item on the agenda. You certainly could have given people
right.
3 minutes,
Kate
and people have talked less than 2 minutes.
And I happily give Liz speaking.
Oh, did you say Anathanism?
No, I said Kate.
Okay,
sorry. That's
me.
Sorry.
Go ahead.
Because I'm going to pass
okay.
it on to
yeah.
someone that wants to speak.
Okay. No, he's very consistent and transparent for everybody, which is what we're trying to do.
I'm Katie Della Maggiore. I wear many hats in the Los Altos Public Schools. I have three children, one who's 3 years old, another one who's in first grade, and another one who's playing softball. And one of my favorite parts about being in Los Altos is the fact that she plays softball. And it doesn't matter whether she's on the orange team, the purple team, or whatever team. She plays on the team, and there are kids from all over the community. The collaboration and communication that goes across that team of sports players is amazing. I'm encouraging communications with my kids all the time, and I want to see that same thing happen between Bullis School Board as well as LASD School Board. I hope that communication and collaboration can continue, more discussion and transparency with the community can happen about this plan. The sentiment across this room seems to be, we're rushing into this plan. People aren't thrilled because it's a scary, new, unsure plan. We're not sure that this is going to be the long-term solution. To sign on to something for 10 years is a little scary to all of us, not knowing what could happen if this, if we hit some threshold, if we hit some maximum, some lower point. There's a lot of unknowns. I feel like more collaboration and communication. I'm a data person. So can we do some math to say moving this campus to San Antonio Center will be minimal distance across the school district and accommodate people better than being here? Can we do some quantifiable measurements on locations of campuses, whether this is the best? Maybe it is the best to have that campus in the whole site. I don't know that, and I would like to see the numbers to prove some of these alternatives are better than one versus the other. Thank you for your time.
Hi, my name is Don Gardner. I've been a resident of Los Altos for 6 years. Hi there, I'm being videotaped. You're going to like me because I have the opposite viewpoint, so I'm being very brave right now. Before living in Los Altos, I lived in across the street.
Can you speak
up? Sorry, I'm being videotaped.
We're just streaming live for people who couldn't make it because there's another meeting at the same time.
Okay, I used to live across the street in Klein Park, where there's now a four-story condominium being built within the boundaries of Los Altos School District. So I know there's going to be a lot of new students moving in, and I see why we need to build another school. I moved from that site to Los Altos in the hope of getting into Bullis Charter. That was one of my main goals for moving into Los Altos. It is our neighborhood school. My son goes here, and we ride our bike or walk to school here every day. I think both Bullis Charter and Los Altos School Districts are both outstanding schools. We really think that education and the children are first, and that's, I think, what we are all here for. So it really baffles me that a two-year school is being argued over so much. Bullis Charter has been waiting for 15 years. I've been following it all the years I've lived here in Mountain View and now in Los Altos for a permanent home. And I understand that the mediated agreement is by far what looks like the best option, because you're looking at funds that come from Mountain View with the building. You're looking at the Cole site, which I lived there 23 years before moving here, and I think it's a perfectly safe neighborhood for a school. I think that the several-year wait that the agreement comes with is unfortunately a long wait, but it is a compromise. Part of the compromises that were made in the previous agreement, the availability of funding, I already mentioned in my time left Sunday.
All right, Ryan Brown.
Hi. My name is Ryan Brown. I grew up in Los Altos and recently moved back to raise two girls, now 4 and 2 years old. I've been removed from the Los Altos schools for 2 decades, and I've tried to catch up some over the past couple weeks. With admittedly limited background, I'd like to briefly put myself in your shoes and share two perspectives on the proposed agreement. The first perspective is that this agreement is a big win for the Bullis Charter School. It seems you've successfully optimized your model around the rules of the system, and the agreement represents the culmination of a thoughtful strategy end up with your preferred structure and curriculum now on your own spacious, desirably located campus. The second perspective is that this agreement is only a short-term win. The agreement will leave the Los Altos School District community with a deep sense of loss from surrendering its neighborhood-centric junior high. The result will be elevated anger manifesting itself in the perpetuation of legal and political battles. In short, the proposed agreement carries out carries our larger school community further down the current path of contention and division. As hard as it may be to pass up the apparent win, I recommend looking past it in favor of identifying a solution more sustainable over the long term. I urge you to take the time with the broader LaSalta School District community in a transparent process that results in a solution where one side doesn't walk away feeling devastated. I have confidence that given the appropriate time and process, you and the LaSalta School District can build a symbiotic relationship that leaves all LaSalta's kids better off. Thank you.
Fatih Olgan.
My name is Fatih Olgan. I'm a parent to a LaSalta School District children. I have two boys going to Covington Elementary. It seems like I don't have anything perfect prepared, so bear with me. It seems like one group is totally happy and one group is totally unhappy. So I don't know how it is going to be for the greater good of our community if the LASD and the BCS came together into a closed room, came up with an agreement. And one side, LSD side, is totally devastated. The other side, so happy. That is gonna come back, and in the long run, it's gonna hurt us all in the community. So I would like there to be more discussions, more openness, and delay in this deal. We need BCS to have discussion scheduled hours, just like LSD did, so people can go. We can ask questions. We want to be able to ask, why do you think that 10th site is good for middle school? Why? So we need to ask. We need to be able to ask, and you guys need to be able to explain to us why is it going to be good for LASD as well, not just for BCS, but good for LASD as well. We don't know what BCS parents think most of the time. Most of the time, we've been coming to meetings. There's maybe like one or two token BCS parents. We are not seeing much BCS parents voicing their opinions. I'm not sure if they are scared or what it is that it is holding them back. Majority of this crowd here is from LASD public school. And I think that there is something that to be determined from there. Maybe we are the ones who you guys need to pay more attention, because we are telling you guys what we want. I like the idea of the 10th school site. Perhaps for A school something, but it's a good idea. Thank you very much.
And okay. All right. So that concludes the public comment, and we'll open up for a board discussion amongst the board. Do I have any volunteers, or should I start picking points that right?
Respectfully disagree, and we may never agree on all the issues, but but it is disheartening at the same time to see some of the comments out there and the behavior of some of the parents out there. The kids are looking, and I think that's really, really unfortunate. I want peace, and that is being top of my mind for a long time. I think a long-term agreement makes sense, you know, in theory. I think a long-term agreement makes sense. You know, I have a mentor who I respect very much, who has been in a lot of boards, and once we were talking about a very long city council meeting and how it went on and on and on, and people were discussing and commenting, and he was telling me how over his many years of service he learned that discussions are better when there is a motion on the table, right? Because then you're discussing about something tangible. We have something tangible today. Whether we like it or not, it is tangible, and having a discussion around something tangible versus the thousands of possibilities that, by the way, have been discussed for the last 5 years, year and a half. I'm sure very smart people have been involved in those meetings and a lot of the ideas that were discussed. So I like it that we have something to be discussed on the table, and that makes any conversation more productive, and the possibility of moving forward more likely. That's kind of the high-level thoughts that I had after.
Thank you, everybody, for coming tonight and sharing your thoughts. And we can certainly listen and take to heart everything that's said from LASD parents and former LASD parents and former Bullis parents and current Bullis parents. And it is a much wider community than any of us here really represent. I think, you know, the common thread I've been hearing tonight is that this is a rush deal and that there's more time should be needed. I don't actually agree with that. I think that there has been a huge amount of time already invested in this. In fact, I don't remember the exact timeline, but I think the mediation meetings probably started, or the initial conversations on the renewal of the agreement started probably up to a couple of years ago. So these have been discussions that have been going on for a very, very long time. And so it really isn't anything which is a big surprise. You know, I've been associated with this school now for 14 years. My kids have graduated out, one's in college, one's in high school. So I do not sit here with a personal agenda that I want something for my kids. I believe in the model of Bullis, and I believe in peace in the community. And although I've been a parent here for a number of years, I've actually been on this board for 3.5 years. Joined the board, it was at pretty much the beginning of the five-year agreement, and that was one of the reasons why I wanted to be part of the board, and there was a stable, peaceful time in the community. The possibility of a 10-year agreement is phenomenal, whatever the final outcome is, and that is something that I really would like to see happen, and I would like to see at least some element of certainty. And I think that one of the things that's happening right now is that there's a lot of uncertainty out there, and in my opinion, whether it's in the business world, public world, or whatever, uncertainty is always worse than bad news, because if you have bad news or something you disagree with, at least you know how to deal with it. If it's something which is unsure, uncertain, none of us really feel stable. So I'm certainly hoping for a peaceful agreement and something that the majority of
Bullis, I think the incredible thing is that an agreement was actually created. Someone mentioned that there was an assumption that there was one side that was very, very happy with the agreement. I don't think there's anybody that's actually completely happy with the agreement. I mean, everybody had to give. Both sides had to find things to compromise on. And you can find one thing in the agreement and think that's the one thing that any single person would say, that's the one thing I don't like. But everything in the agreement, when the agreement is made and there's compromises, there's balances made with both sides. So there was endless hours and discussions about different models and how do you balance that? But I think it's incredible that there were people from LASD and BCS who met and collaborated to try to create an agreement. I think the idea of an agreement, a 10-year agreement, is actually a wonderful thing because it creates stability for both sides to focus on education.
Wonderful.
I think it would be incredible for people to focus their energy and time and effort and resources focusing on how to create, how to move forward with the educational programs at LASD and BCS and really move forward with that and how can we continue to collaborate and learn from each other. So it would be wonderful to have some stability and predictability so people can do that. I think that, for people who move to Los Altos, they have great options. They can choose to go to their small neighborhood school, which is wonderful, or they can choose to try to, be in a lottery to go to a larger charter school. These are all great options, and I think it'd be wonderful if the community could work together to just continue to grow and develop and work together collaborating. I think it's good that there's finally tangible agreement on the table that was created through a lot of hard work with people on both sides.
Was part of the team that negotiated this agreement as well as the one 5 years ago. And I can assure you that both sides gave a lot. Many, many options were considered, with not a single option. Nobody got what they wanted. That's part of negotiating. 5 years ago, it was similar. We had a very hard negotiation, but it did result in peace. And the community was able to grow together and get along. And part of the goal here was we realized 5 years was not a long time. The goal was to have a little longer agreement that takes a long time. We started a year and a half ago in mediation. We worked with a judge. We have gone through many, many rounds and many, many ideas, and this was the deal that surfaced that. Many things that I personally are not crazy about, but that's all part of the process. And I think that's what we should report.
I've got two daughters, first and a third grader. We moved here from Boston about 5 years ago, and we moved here just as the five-year agreement was about to go into place. And I think that has shaped my experience with this community, as I think it has shaped many. And I talked to folks on this board in the community about what it's like sort of before and after. And I was excited when I moved here to discover that there was a period of peace for people where from the district and the charter were finally coming to some sort of agreement to be able to come to terms and not talk about facilities every day and instead be able to focus on other things. And that was really important to me. So professionally, I work in education. I worked in urban public education for over a decade, and I have worked both from the charter sector in districts and then worked in nonprofits that worked with both. I have seen the tension, the antagonism that comes across, and I've spent my career jumping back and forth between the two, trying to find ways to knit communities together and see commonality across educators and parents want the same thing for their kids. You have different ways of doing it, but a governance structure should not divide a community and it shouldn't divide people. So I was really hopeful when coming to this community to see that there was a moment of sort of, and it, what seemed like an inflection point to actually lead towards collaboration and cooperation. And that's sort of shaped my experience in the community as well. And that value of finding peace and finding opportunities, as Trina said, to focus on education and to focus on the things that are what we really want the boards and folks to be focusing on is really important to me. And to me, when I thought about coming into this facilities situation, that was something that I was willing to make compromises for in order to have a longer term agreement, to have stability for both sides to enable that kind of collaboration to happen. When I think about this deal in particular, I hear a sense of being rushed, a sense of wait, we've just heard about this, what is this deal? And a sense of education. I've heard a number of people say, what does PCS think? What do parents think? I don't hear them in district meetings. And I think that that's incredibly hard, and part about this process is so hard is that the negotiating teams have been working for a year and a half, and there's been conversations before then. They've been working incredibly hard to try to come to a deal or an agreement that both sides can live with. And that's hard to do full stop, and I think people, they're working really diligently to try to do that. I know when we came to, in February we had a meeting, we had 18 speakers, some of you were here tonight. I took notes on all of them, and of those 18 speakers, 12 explicitly called for either collaboration or compromise. And I really appreciated that, because I think that's, and it was calling both boards to the table to get together and figure out a deal that we could get something done instead of just being antagonistic. And I think that really lit a fire under both sides to get together and come to a deal. And it's one that both sides consider a million different possibilities and that both sides could live with, even if they didn't like it all in the place. And I would say that I've been listening a lot to parents over the last several weeks about this specific deal. Had dozens of conversations with parents, mostly with Bullis parents, but with some district parents as well. Today alone, I had a dozen emails. And overwhelming, the sentiment that I have heard from the Bullis parents that I have spoken with predominantly was that it's not a perfect deal, it's not a great deal, but it's one that we should move ahead with and work with. There are a number of folks within the Bullis community who say, look, I think we might be giving up too much in a number of different ways, including, we're still split, or there's another 5 years before we might even get to a single site. We're capping enrollment in a way that means we're going to have to turn away 1,000 families that want to be a part of the school, and that feels really hard for some people in our community. And that is a challenge, and I think it's something that we're, however, though, are willing to compromise on in order to get facilities that are reasonably equivalent for our families and our students who are also in taxpayer-funded public schools, and that those taxpayer dollars that are going to fund these facilities are should be to the benefit of all public school students, district and charter. I don't think that we're asking for, or have ever asked for the top of the line, the best, the like better than anyone else. We just want something that's reasonably important for the kids in this school as well, and to have some stability over time. And so when I think about this deal, I think it is imperfect, and I absolutely agree that we need to spend more time educating folks on what some of the trade-offs and what the desires were, and I know that as a purpose process, and it's hard to have time to do that with everyone, but I think that it's, I can't in good conscience vote against something that I think could actually be really good for the community long-term, especially with so many other options that they've considered and haven't been able to come to. So that's what I'm saying.
Thank you. appreciate you coming. And I would also like to extend an invitation for anybody who wants to actually dialogue, talk to me. I'd be happy to talk to any of you. I've always been willing to talk to somebody who's a person as well. But if you really want to understand a little more about our perception of things. Everybody sort of talked about bona fides in the community, and this is why it's important, review is important. So I'm going to do a little bit of that. There's a point, not just to give the bio, but really talk about the process, because what a lot of you have objected to is the sense of the process, it doesn't work, there's too much time. So my first involvement with Los Altos School District was probably a little after I bought a house there in the late 80s, and I worked on the first parcel tax. Mid-90s, I went on the council with the Rotary and various field user groups. That was a soccer coach, I was a coach. So we had AYSL, we had Pony, and Little League. Other groups, we got money together to do work at this Indian site and also at Block. Negotiated deals, used the two gyms, the city-owned gyms, those were my idea. Negotiated with the district, got them through. Negotiated with the school district 2003, 2005, worked out deals that ultimately didn't agree to, all sort of, but district didn't. Long history of negotiating with the school district. I served on the Citizens Advisory Committee for Finance, school district committee. I think it's been helpful. It's been in charge for about 25 years. I don't view this as us versus them. It shouldn't be. We are part of the community. Although, remember, we as a new member, ASD is 80%, the southern part of the town. Very unhappy if they don't sleep. So we do have the Latino school district here as well. Process, I can't really talk about what we said in negotiations in this cover. But I think part of the reason that these are done by the backup stories is something either party can throw out really creative solutions. Maybe when you first see them, it sound like they could be promising, but actually maybe an hour later you realize they're sort of stupid. It's good to be able to do that, to brainstorm, to see what you can come up with. What I can tell you is this was mostly done in a non-adversarial way. I don't view negotiations as a zero-sum game. It's interest-based, sometimes called interest-based bargaining. I always believe to get more done if you figure out what everybody else wants as well. You put everything out there, and you see how much of what everybody wants you can get. That's sort of what we did here. That is actually what we tried to do. Of course, there are places where we disagreed. Clearly, neither side likes or thinks this is what we would have wanted. But I think we think this is the best that we could reach. We have two sides that have some fundamental disagreements. And clearly we have different interests in the sense that there's a limited set of facilities to be divvied up. So some tension was natural. Specifically, obviously, we gave one a cap, right? I just let me throw this out there. Prime, one of the big things that the district will tell you is the public part, they didn't want it was a cap on enrollment. So think about a situation where perhaps the main thing is we have a school and so many people want to go to it. They've got for turning away hundreds and hundreds of kids every year. And the prime goal for one of the parties is to make sure you don't accept, you don't allow those extra children to be admitted. It's an interesting goal. It's a goal. District got its main goal. What we get is we get stability. 10 years would be nice if we had longer. And what do we really know we have? We have sites at Eden and Rock. What are you all talking about? tell you about the closure of Eden. This isn't in our control. These aren't our facilities. So I reiterate that if you'd like to talk further, I'd love to do it. We sat next to each other actually last week. I was sort of surprised to see your email.
Yeah.
So I try to make the meeting more often.
Our oldest, she's in fourth grade. When she started, we were in what I call peace time. Right? So I've never known any of this divisiveness and acrimony that I've been talking about. And was pretty much shielded from that since I started her Bullis. And I heard about it, but I didn't really know to be accurate stories and so on. But in the last, I'd say 6 to 8 months, I really lived it and I feel what everyone's talking about. I attended one of the LSD board meetings. It was a rainy night, and they were going over some proposals, and you're mentioning there was a cry for collaboration that really moved me. It really did. I came back, went home, and just spoke to my wife about it, and said, we've got to get something done, because we need to partner and collaborate with the district. And so, you know, the three of us, I spent countless hours, my wife can attest to this, trying to figure out a solution. We worked through every nook and cranny. I'm not in education. I learned a lot about things like strands and configurations and things I'd never even known existed. And these are difficult problems, right? And I thought I worked in some difficult situations at work, but these are some really difficult challenges that we face with. And there are times where I didn't think we would get anything done. Discussions with Jessica and Brian, who I also want to thank, you know, where at times they were difficult, where there's disagreement, discord, frustration, but at the same time, there was a lot of partnership, empathy, collaboration, and compromise, trying to get something done for the benefit of the broader community. And so, you know, we think we landed there. We both parties negotiated, I believe, in good faith, to try to get something done that worked for the broader good. No deal is perfect. Every deal has its warts. Right? There are things in this deal I look back on. I still read the agreement, and I regret certain things, or I wish we had certain things, and I can't believe you conceded on this and that. And that's just the way these things work. Right? No deal is going to be perfect. There are always people that are going to be unhappy with whatever we agree to, and that's just kind of what it is. But I do believe that for both school districts, for broader community,
So, sometimes when I talk in public and I'm unsure of how the conversation's going to go, or at least I'm unsure of how I feel, it's to continue to be a room full of folks that don't necessarily see the world the way we do, and have to have that dialogue. And I say to myself, I try to imagine that I'm sitting in a room and talking to friends, or talking to neighbors. And in this case, it's actually true, right? We are neighbors.
We are
colleagues. We are, hopefully, friends. I've had drinks with all of you. Sam, having you in the front seat makes it a lot easier to have a conversation like this, because we've both been friends. We've had conversations about this. This isn't easy, and I think all of us, whether we collective
five older members, particularly the ones already initiated to. Because even if you don't agree with the proposed agreement on the outcome of these negotiations, these are people that have collectively spent hundreds of hours over months and years to try and get everybody to the best possible place they could. And you know, we've all heard the optimism, the hallmark of a good deal is one that makes nobody happy. Everybody can find fault with this deal. It is not a perfect deal. It is the best that we could come up with after significant community input in forums large and small martyred by LASA, in forums hosted by independent groups, the Creative Facility Solutions. The BCS board has had meetings. We've had meetings together with LASD board members, open all public, open to the community. We've had emails, we've had phone calls, we've been approached on the street, we've been approached in people's living rooms. And when you look at, and Francis, you're hitting nail on the head, right? We're talking about trying to come up with a reasonable way to divide limited facilities in a reasonably equivalent, as my colleague Amwan Leroy mentioned, fashion. You tried litigation, horrible, right? I'm a lawyer, even I hate lawyers, and I'm a lawyer. Right? You don't want to be a lawyer. Sorry, Francis. I love you. We've tried a state law mandated adversarial process, Prop 39, right? Where you have the two sides coming together with time pressure to try and force resolve the outcome. We've tried a voluntary 5-year agreement, which of the 15 years that I've been watching the school committee, those are five of the best years. A lot of the people that you know nothing about the acrimony or the history of BCS and LASD, the reason why they don't know anything is because we've had 5 years of peace and calm and stability in the community, right? And those are two sides in a process very similar to this, coming together with agreement that, yet did not make either side happy, but both sides agreed to for the greater good of the community. I feel the pain. It's a trite statement, but I hear you. I'm watching the looks on your faces. I've been looking at the crowd. I've watched videos of the LASD board meetings. I have neighbors and friends that grew up in Los Angeles as well. I hear the pain, the anger, in the community, or in some portions of the community. There are also a lot of people that may not be in the room tonight, but have also made their thoughts and feelings. Elected officials from three towns, Los Altos, Los Altos Hills, and Mountain. BCS Paris, a big community, and the community to which, as a board member, I've got a fiduciary obligation to those parents. But again, as a neighbor and colleague, I've got, and a citizen, and a taxpayer, and a voter, I have an interest in what goes on for the greater good of Los Altos and the people of Los Altos School District as well. These schools belong to all of us. They're not our schools. They're not our neighborhood schools. They're not the only Los Altos School District schools. They are our schools. We pay taxes here, we live here, we vote here. Just like the president does not own the White House, no elected official, the district does not own these schools. They are our schools. And just like I'm looking at that sign saying save our neighborhood schools, I think residents of North El Camino might have something to say about that as well, who pay taxes and live in a district that prides itself on neighborhood schools. They've got some rights too, and they've got the right to be heard. I think the Mountain View City Council, working with LASD, they did a tremendous job to come up with an outcome that delivers benefits and services to residents in that area as well. As a BCS parent and as a taxpayer here, I pay taxes to the district and parcel taxes just like each of you. I want to see my tax dollars count in exactly the same way as you do. And coming up with an agreement that provides for long-term stability does not closing of a school. It does not. Egan is not closing. People are getting a $100 million brand new state-of-the-art school. In what community is that considered not good enough? Do you know how many communities would kill to have a brand new school, $100 million, you know, people contributing, you know, park and loo fees and everything, for a $100 million state-of-the-art school, and parks and resources for a community that's been underserved for decades? And I think about this, right? So we've come up with an agreement that wasn't rushed. It wasn't forced. There were parties on both sides negotiating. Each side gave. Each side took. I don't know if that's the right proper phrase. But this wasn't bum rushed through under the cover of darkness, you know, with one side trying to flex on the other. These are two groups of people that have the community interests at heart. And nothing has changed for me as it did 3 weeks ago when LASD and the BCS, you know, negotiating teams brought this agreement to the townspeople. This is the best opportunity we have at long last for a long time to come to bring stability and certainty and peace to this district. You may not feel that way now, but there's also similar pain and similar anger and similar fear at other times in this long and sort of history when either schools are being closed or Bullis was being split onto two districts, or two sites rather, or when the proposal was to move Bullis out of the district. You know, there was a tearful board meeting then at LASD, or most recently, with the most recent Prop 39, the proposal was split with Bullis onto three campuses. And I look at all of those past efforts and past opportunities and I say, all right, I look at this agreement that, yes, as Francis mentioned and others on the board, there's a significant gift in that, you know, once again, we have to tell parents that want to avail themselves of the choice for their children, that a Bullis education won't be available to them because we've agreed to a cap of exchange for long-term facilities. That's a hard thing to say to parents, right, who have the right to choose the school. I feel, and I've used this analogy, I speak for myself because not everyone likes it when I use it, but it almost feels like, you know, you're in the castle pulling up the drawbridge, you know, and then people on the other side of the moat looking in. And I hate that feeling. That's what I feel personally. I'm not speaking for the school there, but I hate that feeling, to tell parents that they can't have that choice for their children. And what I also hope is, just like BCS and LASD have collaborated in the past, right? We collaborated many times for the sake of students when it's a natural emergency, the smoke in the room. You know, I've got Jeff Baer right here in my speed dump, and half the trustees in my speed dump. We talk all the time, and BCS works with other schools in Santa Clara County, exchanging ideas and, you know, thought leadership and exchanges all the time. And I'd like for the ability to come back to that time in LASD when we can really look at this as 1 + 1 = 3. We are all strengthened by LASD schools, just like we are all strengthened by having a choice in BCS. And I want to get back to that time period. I understand that's not the sentiment in the room tonight. I understand that people have threatened, and I think the quote is permanent acrimony, if this deal goes through. I hope that's not the case. And I don't want to see it because people will only rise as they hear me speak. I hope that's not the case. Because I like to think that all of us living together, having beers, bumping into each other on the street, having our kids playing sports, can recognize that we all live here, we all breathe the same air, we all want the same thing for our children and our society at large. And that's to give everybody an opportunity to be educated and to have the choice of their educational program. So, we're going to call it. And we're going to, as a board, signal our agreement or disagreement with the chosen. And I hope that for those even who may not agree with the outcome tonight, whatever that outcome may be, I hope you recognize at least that you've given this serious thought. You've heard and listened. You do care. And we can go forward, you know, tomorrow and have tomorrow be another day. Okay. So moving on to agenda item 4A, proposed tenure facilities agreement with the Los Altos School District. Can I have a motion? The motion is to approve.
I don't have a next time.
The motion is to approve the tenure. The motion is to approve the tenure facilities agreement and authorize duly authorized signatory to sign.
Authorize an officer
to sign and give the time period on that. Authorize an officer to sign.
Can I have a motion, please? I move that we adopt the tenure agreement with the Los Altos School District and authorize any part of our board of officers to execute the agreement on behalf of the Los Altos School.
Okay, can I have a second, please?
Okay. And Marty Roy.
All right. All those in favor, signify aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Any opposed? Motion passes. Thank you very much. We're now going to go to close. Can we go to close? Yeah. Let's take a 5-minute break. I saw there's some young children in the audience. Thank you very much.